A warm welcome to the start of our seventh annual seminar series at the International at the Refugee Law Initiative on International Refugee Law. It gives me very great pleasure to introduce our speaker for this evening, Mr. Jean-François Durieux, who I'll introduce in greater detail in a couple of moments. I would just say it's lovely to see so many of you round the table and sort of further away. Apologies to those at the back, if you can't hear us, that's enough. This seminar series follows on from the sixth seminar series, which looked in great deal of detail at the European response to a large-scale movement that's been happening into Europe in the last couple of years, particularly comprised of Syrian refugees, but also refugees of other nationalities. This year, we take the same topic and the concerns around large-scale movements and think about them particularly in the context of the international meetings and the supposed framework which was developed last month on the 19th of September in the UN General Assembly's meeting on large-scale movements of refugees and migrants. So that forms the overall parameter, the overall umbrella for our seminar series this year. We've got a whole range of speakers lined up, approximately one per month, for the rest of this year. You can see that they touch on many, many aspects of large-scale movements, of refugees and migrants, and the particular protection and legal issues involved there. So we have speakers from the IOM talking about the migration aspect, those from UNHCR talking about refugee protection and mixed migration. We have people who've taken a more empirical look at trying to map out some of those movements and what the particular protection issues that arise from that are. We've got to look at the end of the deterrence paradigm as a possible way of moving this debate forward. And finally, a look at EU law and the politics of mass influx. And on this question of mass influx, it's appropriate, I think, for me to turn to our speaker for this evening, Mr. Jean-François Durieux, who many of you will know has written not only on issues of mass influx, but also many other aspects of the refugee regime, as well as being a scholar of absolutely stunning diversity in terms of the range of topics on which he's written. He also, for many years, was in the field of refugee practice, with UNHCR particularly, ending up as their director of operations in Geneva, having carried out field missions all across the world in many interesting places such as Myanmar, and also, I believe, you were in Central America for a period of time. So, Jean-François Durieux, on top of his many distinctive roles within the UN, was also, until very, very recently, the director of the Institute of International Humanitarian Law in San Marino, where he was passing on some of his accumulated knowledge to governments and NGO workers from around the world and organising programmes of protection and on other refugee and IDP-related issues. Without further ado, it gives me very great pleasure to give him the floor to speak about one protocol yet to be drafted, what treaty law can and cannot do to advance refugee protection. So over to you, Jean-François.
Thank you very much, David. Thank you all for being here. I'll try to stand. I improvise a lectern here so that I can see you better. I hope you hear me. Yeah? So far, so good. So, what treaty law can and cannot do to advance refugee protection? That indeed is the title. Everybody agrees that the international refugee regime is in a worrying health condition. Eminent doctors and healers have again been called to its bedside, trying to revitalize it with a mix of old and new medication. The question that this talk seeks to address could be phrased in the following terms: is there room for hard international law in the prescription? That would be old medication, clearly, considering that 48 years have passed since the last Treaty on Refugees was adopted in the form of the African Union Convention of 1969, itself the only regional supplement to a foundational treaty, the 51 Convention, that saw the light of day 65 years ago. Last month, the New York Declaration, of which you may have heard, reaffirm the 1951 Convention and the 1967 Protocol as the foundation of the international refugee protection regime. As solemnly as the ministerial meeting of states parties had done in December 2001. Important as they may be, these reaffirmations sound increasingly ritualistic and empty. Indeed, what is it that is so solemnly reaffirmed? At the risk of caricaturing, I would say, one, a refugee definition that produces highly inconsistent outcomes, two, a regime of rights that really looks its age, and three, a rule of non-refoulement that has long been superseded by development in human rights law. For it is worth observing that while hard refugee law was staying still, hard human rights law was in constant motion. Therefore, ritualistic reaffirmations of the relevance and resilience of the 1951 Convention worry me. For at the end of the day, they also serve to expose the limitations of that legal framework. The most disturbing part, however, is that declarations such as those adopted in 2001 in Geneva or in 2016 in New York do not propose to fix any of the gaps they duly identify within the regime by resorting to hard law. Not only do they fail to recognize that the best thing that ever happened to the 1951 Convention is its 1967 Protocol, they also avoid any reference to legal obligations where they sketch out the future of the regime, preferring the language of principles and vague commitments. Judging from its recurrence in political declarations, in soft law, and in the preamble to the 1951 Convention, the principle most deserving of an upgrade to binding status would appear to be that of international cooperation, also known as international solidarity, often paired with burden and responsibility sharing. And of course, this is where the big rub is. As every new refugee crisis demonstrates, nothing can be more damaging to respect for the 1951 Convention than the feeling of injustice that prevails among refugee-receiving states and societies when they realize that their legal duty not to return refugees is not matched by any firm obligation on more distant states to share the cost, let alone the caseload. Even in well-resourced states, such as the UK, Denmark, Australia, politicians in government have threatened to burn the 1951 Convention at the stake for its failure to provide a measure of predictability in the distribution of asylum responsibilities among state parties. So am I going to suggest that weak commitments to a more equitable sharing of responsibilities should be solidified through hard law? Well, no. But if I were, I would be in respectable company. Only months after the 2001 ministerial meeting had reaffirmed the centrality of the 1951 Convention, then High Commissioner for Refugees, Lubbers, planted the seeds of a lawmaking project which he boldly dubbed Convention Plus. The aim of this initiative was, I quote, to improve refugee protection and to facilitate the resolution of refugee problems worldwide through multilateral special agreements. In his mind, such special agreements, a notion found in the original Statute of UNHCR, were clearly of the binding type, and they were to address pressing issues that, and again I quote, the 51 Convention and the 67 Protocol could not address, including how responsibility for admitting and protecting refugees can best be shared, end of quote. That was Convention Plus. It passed. Even though many states agreed to participate in the negotiations, this effort hit a dead end in 2005, as indeed many inside and outside UNHCR had predicted. All it had generated was a non-binding multilateral framework of understandings on refugee resettlement. Probably unaware of this history, because institutional memory is remarkably short within the UN, The next High Commissioner for Refugees returned to the topic 10 years later, in 2015. As he was about to leave office, High Commissioner Antonio Guterres told his executive committee, I quote, "If there is one protocol that is yet to be drafted to complement the 1951 Convention, it is one on international solidarity and burden sharing," unquote. Did he seriously mean it? Did he seriously mean a protocol? Was he committing his office to this objective? One has reason to doubt it, since, as I observed a few minutes ago, there's absolutely no reference to low development in the New York Declaration or in its refugee-related annex. But in any event, what we must ask ourselves is, should we push for it? Should we push for such a protocol on solidarity and burden sharing? My take on this is fairly straightforward. I believe that Mr. Guterres identified the right arrow, but not the right target. There is one protocol, indeed more than one protocol yet to be drafted to complement the 1951 Convention. However, the subject matter should not be international solidarity and burden sharing. I'm convinced of this not only in view of the failure of past efforts such as Convention Plus, but more fundamentally in view of what I know about the ways in which treaty law develops. In short, a protocol to the 51 Convention on burden sharing would not succeed because it would have no anchor in any binding provision of the mother instrument. The situation would be different if we had on the book, say, a convention on territorial asylum or equivalent, stipulating a duty to admit and settle refugees. Likewise, one could envisage a protocol to the 1969 African Convention on Refugees, clarifying the burden-sharing clause, which is contained in Article 2 of this instrument. But for its part, the 1951 Convention is simply not about asylum as a shared responsibility. It is actually silent about the interstate dimension of international protection and focuses instead on the vertical relationship between state and refugee. This being the case, to deal with responsibility sharing through a protocol to the convention would be far-fetched. It would be the legal equivalent of doing the splits, and all treaties, like old men, are not flexible enough for this type of exercise, I'm afraid. This is no reason, however, for abandoning the concept or the ambition of protocols altogether. Lawmaking through protocols to the 1951 Convention can be a realistic project if it is properly scoped. That is, if it targets for enhancement or clarification standards that are present, albeit underdeveloped, within the original instrument. Under this approach, what matters is to find the right anchors in the Convention. I intend to show that Article 1 and Article 35 of the Convention are strong candidates for such a role anchor. If we are to take a bolder approach, we can also conceive of protocols that would affect a package of convention provisions. A protocol on refugee children would be a case in point, as would the introduction of a derogation mechanism in situations of mass influx. Before I detail these proposals, however, I deem it important to address and hopefully dispel some of the objections that I've heard and that you may raise against the lawmaking project as a whole. The first objection may be, well, we don't want to risk losing what we've got. It's probably true that within the current political context, to reopen the convention will inevitably lead to unraveling the important protections it contains. But on this, I just need to point out that additional protocols which build upon the original treaty do not carry such a risk. They do not reopen the convention, they add to it. And I would even say they serve to reaffirm the validity of the treaty while injecting a new dynamism into it. A more serious objection against additional protocols may be connected to their optional character. Here the risk is to create a two-tier system whereby some states assume deeper or wider obligations than others, or adopt advanced procedures or interpretations while other regime participants lag behind. Well, yes, indeed. This risk is inherent in all optional protocols, but this is bad. I would counter a view that the mere existence of a fast lane can act as a magnet, in that those states that lag behind will have a finger clearly pointed at them. Moreover, let's face it, variable geometry and asymmetric obligations already characterize the international refugee protection regime based on the 51 Convention. In many areas, including those I deem right for a protocol, the domestic legislation and or the case law of many states is far ahead of a strict application of convention provisions. This is seen as positive, and indeed it is. What such local advances lack, however, is global impact. True, the dialogue between national courts has improved, at least within the universe of common law, so that decisions in one state can influence the jurisprudence of others. But don't you think that this progress would be more solid if it were translated into hard law of potentially universal application? This leads me to a third possible objection, focusing this time on feasibility. Assuming that protocols can be adopted, what happens if the rate of ratification is low? Wouldn't that weaken the whole legal edifice, bring it into disrepute? This objection must be taken seriously. For one thing, it requires one to be strategic about the choice of protocols. In order to gain traction among state parties, fresh protocols should build upon developing state practice and case law in a few key areas, well-selected area of convention-based obligations. At the same time, it's not forbidden to be ambitious or to take legal risks. The second additional protocol to the 1949 Geneva Conventions on the law of war has been ratified by only a fraction of state party to the original conventions. Yet, can we say that IHL would be stronger without it? I don't think so. Finally, I'm aware that some may raise a fundamental objection on feasibility, arguing that it will be impossible to muster enough political will to even initiate a process of protocol drafting. To this, I would say three things. One, we won't know until we try. Two, the initiative must necessarily be taken by UNHCR, and I recognize that it takes some courage. But no one can dispute that such an initiative would fall squarely within the mandate that the agency has received from the General Assembly. And three, several options are open regarding the drafting and adoption process. The 1967 protocol was drafted by 13 independent experts, sitting for a week or two, a month maybe, in a nice place in Italy. At the end of the process, the General Assembly just took note of it. Pretty smooth. Okay, those may have been easier times, but I'm sure that even today, creative ways can be found around the usual traps of treaty negotiation. Good. So, subject to objections I've not considered, let's turn to substance. And as mentioned, I believe that protocols to the 51 Convention are needed and feasible in four areas. Gender-based persecution. As is well known, Article 182 of the Convention defines a refugee as a person with a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership in a particular social group, or political opinion. These grounds for persecution are listed exhaustively. Over the past three decades, gender-based persecution has been recognized by an ever-growing number of jurisdictions and by UNHCR as giving rise to refugee status through a creative interpretation of the ground membership in a particular social group. Most of you know this. But does this make sense? To be frank, I fail to understand those advocates of women's rights and gender equality who insist that membership in a particular social group is the right vehicle for gender-based claim. Creativity cannot be an end in itself, especially where the objective is to give the visibility it deserves to a widespread and vicious form of persecution. Visibility requires that gender, or at least sex, be openly acknowledged as a ground for persecution in the refugee definition. We owe this not only to the actual and potential victims, but also to the very concept of refugee, which needs to be understood by the public at large in order to survive. I always found that the best way to explain the notion of persecution for reasons of is to define it as an aggravated form of discrimination. You, David, have expressed the same idea in much more precise legal terms in Human Rights and the Refugee Definition, where you wrote, I quote, "The starting point for understanding the relationship between the Article 182 refugee definition and international human rights law is a concept of non-discrimination expressed by the element of convention grounds," unquote. I fully agree. This being the case, why can't we call a spade a spade? Admit that the 1951 convention lags behind human rights law in its ignorance of gender and help it catch up. We can look at all the human rights instruments at our disposal. Both covenants, the European American African Human Rights Instrument, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Convention on Migrant Workers, the EU Charter, all contain prohibitions on discrimination that list sex or gender as the first ground of prohibited discrimination. So, to be sure, their list of grounds are actually much more expansive than that. And sex or gender is probably not the only candidate for admission into Article 1 of the 1951 Convention. It is simply the most urgent, and I would submit the easiest one. More than a dozen states have incorporated that ground into their domestic refugee legislation. And case law has achieved the same result in many more countries, albeit through some unnecessary acrobatics. Number two, refugee children. Speaking of low-hanging fruit, my next candidate for protocol making would be the protection of refugee children. Children represent over 50% of the refugee population worldwide, and their plight rightly attracts much sympathy. The legal framework through which refugee children are protected extends far beyond the 1951 Convention, including, of course, the Convention on the Rights of the Child and its own protocols, as well as a rich array of declarations, conclusions, guidelines on such matters as birth registration, family reunification, adoption, education, early childhood development, detention, etc. The idea here would be to extract from these supplementary and mostly uncontroversial sources a cohesive set of refugee child-specific provisions. The resulting protocol would, to a large extent, reproduce international law obligations that many states have already assumed. Its purpose would therefore be to update the 1951 Convention, building upon protections that are generically present within the original instrument, while stressing the specific needs and rights of a population of special concern. I don't have the text of these protocols with me, but of course, they're not drafted yet, just ideas. Number three, supervision. Well, it is trite knowledge that optional protocols to human rights instruments often serve the purpose of establishing or strengthening, monitoring and supervision mechanisms. It's equally well known that the 1951 Convention does not provide for any independent treaty monitoring body or peer review mechanism. Article 35 refers to UNHCR as the organization charged with supervising the application of the convention provisions, and it obliges states to provide UNHCR in the appropriate form with information concerning the condition of refugees, the implementation of the convention, and domestic law and regulations related to refugees. This is a rather weak supervision mechanism out of line with mainstream human rights law. especially since the reports called for by Article 35, where they exist, are treated by UNHCR as confidential. An entire generation of refugee scholars and advocates trained on more recent human rights standards have consistently exposed incongruence of this provision. And they've called for either the establishment of a full-fledged treaty monitoring body or, at a minimum, a public peer review of state practices in implementing the convention. These critics acknowledge that UNHCR supervision functions in practice reach beyond the confines of Article 35, not least through what UNHCR has called operational supervision. That is, the agency's recognized ability to monitor implementation through its extensive field presence, to engage in a constructive, albeit mostly confidential, dialogue with states in order to redress bad practice, to fill gaps, etc. Pressure persists on UNHCR nonetheless to update Article 35 and to exercise its legal supervision responsibility in more robust as well as more predictable ways. During the global consultations that marked the 50th anniversary of the Convention, supervision was identified as one area in need of development, and a number of ideas were put on the table. Interestingly, upon closing that process, closing the Mission meeting that was the culmination of the global consultation process, High Commissioner Lubbers again mentioned the possibility of an optional protocol on this subject. He actually uttered the word. This possibility doesn't seem to have been explored any further, but I believe it should. Is resistance likely to be strong? Yes, probably, though in my view not from all quarters. States in the global north in particular cannot afford to be publicly seen as rejecting in respect of one convention what they have accepted and what they practice in respect of other human rights and treaties. And in any event, without going all the way to the establishment of an independent committee, a protocol on implementation could propose a more regular, more public, and more binding system of reporting, either to UNHCR or by UNHCR. This in itself would represent a major improvement over the prevailing ad hoc approach and a much needed boost to the credibility of the convention. Last but not least, mass influx, a derogation-like procedure. I guess I'm finally approaching the theme of this seminar series, which refers to large-scale movements of refugees. To say that large-scale influxes of refugees constitute a serious challenge to the legal regime based on the 1951 Convention is a gross understatement. I've already alluded to this challenge in the first part of my exposé, where I discussed and then rejected the idea of a protocol on international solidarity. Let me stress again that lack of binding solidarity is the number one factor in the anxiety of refugee-receiving states vis-à-vis the convention regime. However, what I would like to discuss at this juncture is not the cause of such anxiety, but its consequences. Namely, the deteriorating quality of asylum, the substandard conditions under which most of the larger groups of refugees in the world are forced to live, even after a decade or more in exile. What do we see? Where numbers overwhelm the capacity of host states, non-refoulement is bought at the expense of all other rights in the convention, security of the person, freedom of movement, right to work, etc. Contrary to both the letter and spirit of the convention, refugees are held in a legal limbo with, to quote Jeff Crisp, no solution in sight. Implementation of the convention is for all practical purposes frozen. Some time ago, Jane McAdam and I wrote, I quote, "The challenge in mass influxes lies in regulating the manner in which the passing of time affects the accrual of state obligation under the convention," unquote. In that article, called Non-Refoulement Through Time, right, guy, we suggested that under-resourced states facing this type of emergency should be allowed to derogate from some of their treaty obligations, especially in the field of socio-economic rights. To this day, I believe that a formal derogation regime circumscribed by proper guarantees would be highly preferable to the status quo, whereby states facing mass influxes de facto and indefinitely suspend the application of convention standards. And, of course, there is no derogation clause within the 1951 Convention. So should we address this gap through a protocol? Aha. Here I feel your trepidation, and to be honest, I share it. Our vision of a sound protocol is an instrument that establishes additional rights and obligations, not one that limits obligations and suspends rights, albeit for a limited period of time. So clearly, further thought and work is required. Not in my view to question the need for a protocol of this peculiar nature, but to define its contents and its methodology. For example, it may be possible to avoid the term derogation, which sounds, well, derogatory. The emphasis may instead be placed on the important matters, time limits, requirements of necessity and proportionality, and on procedural aspects such as notification, monitoring, and supervision. The central point, though, is and remains the following. If law cannot produce binding burden-sharing norms, we must resort to law in order to give overburdened states a breathing space within strict limits, or witness a further erosion of the convention. So, these are my modest proposals for more hard law on refugees. They stop far short of resolving all the problems that beset the international legal regime. Perhaps they are ill-conceived and protocols should address other issues. But I'm sure of one thing. We cannot be satisfied by a finding that the 1951 Convention is alive if this means that it's not dead yet. Our task is not to keep it alive, it's to make it lively, dynamic, inspirational. As for the 1967 Protocol, well, let us surprise it on its 50th birthday with a happy group of siblings. It's been lonesome far too long. So, welcome to 2017 Protocols. Thank you.